From Washington, D.C., the Department of the Army proudly presents the Bassoon Section of the United States Army Field Band. As part of an ongoing series of instructional videotapes by the United States Army Field Band, we present our Bassoon Section in a discussion of bassoon playing for the student or teacher titled Bassoon Basics. The members of our Bassoon Section are Sergeant First Class Richard Spittle, Sergeant First Class Lynn Peck, and Master Sergeant Roy Carson.
Today, we will discuss much of the basic information that you will need to achieve success as a bassoon student or teacher. The topics we will cover are how to assemble and hold the instrument, tone production, technique, including a video fingering chart, how to choose and adjust reeds, how to ensure that your bassoon is in good repair, and some of the literature that you will play. Throughout the program, we will pause from time to time to play for you because we want you to hear what the bassoon sounds like and also because we like to play trios. Some parts of this tape will have a lot of information, so in those places you may want to pause the tape to copy down things which will be useful to you, or you may want to work with different parts of the tape at different times. To make it easier to find the information you want, we have labeled each section so you can fast forward right to a particular lesson.
The first step in assembling the bassoon is to make sure the case is on a firm surface, either a table or the floor. Also make sure the case is right side up. The handle will go on the bottom half of the case. After opening the case, grasp the boot section by one of the wide metal bands and lift it out of the case. While holding it upright with one hand, grasp the wing joint near the metal band and lift it out of the case. The cork end of the wing joint goes in the smaller of the two holes on the top of the boot joint. Line up the inside curve of the wing joint so it matches the curve of the larger hole on the boot joint. Remember not to grasp any of the parts of the bassoon by the keys. Notice Lynn's hand positions. Next, take the long joint out of the case and put the smaller end in the hole on top of the boot joint. If you have a joint lock, fasten it now. Notice how the keywork looks on a properly assembled bassoon. Lift the bell out of the case, and holding down the pad cup on it, slide it onto the end of the long joint, making sure the key on the bell overlaps the key on the long joint. Next, take the bocal and holding it just above the cork, insert it into the hole on the top of the wing joint. Do not try to swing it from the narrow end, but keep your hand just above the cork and twist it back and forth until it seats. Be careful that the nib on the bocal does not tear at the pad on the key that sticks up above the end of the wing joint. If there is a hand rest, put it in the tube which sticks out of the top of the boot joint. Keep the reed soaking in water or your mouth until you are seated and ready to play. To take the bassoon apart, reverse the order of assembly. Take the reed off and put it in the reed case, or place it in your mouth where it can't be damaged. Take the handrest off and place it in the case. Holding the bocal above the cork, twist it back and forth to take it off the bassoon. Blow through the cork end to remove any moisture that has collected in it. Place it in the case with the nib up. Remove the bell and notice how Lynn is holding the key down for removal. Put the bell in its place in the case. Undo the joint lock. And twist the long joint carefully to remove it from the instrument. And put it in the case. Twist the wing joint to remove it from the boot joint. Turn the boot joint upside down so that any moisture which has collected inside of it will run out of the smaller hole. It is necessary to swab out the wing joint and small side of the boot joint. If you have a straight swab, push it gently into the small side of the boot joint, being careful not to jam it. Twist it and pull it out. Put the boot joint in the case. It is not necessary to swab out the large side of the boot joint. Use an in and out motion to swab the wing joint, but do not force the swab too far into the wing joint. If you have a small drop swab, make sure it is unfolded and pull it by the weighted end through the wing joint a couple of times. If you don't unfold the swab, it may jam in the wing joint when you pull it through. Lay the wing joint in the case next to the long joint. In most bassoon cases, the wing and long joints will lie next to each other, just as when the bassoon is assembled. If you have a long drop swab, unfold it and drop it into the large hole of the boot joint until it hits the bottom. Then turn the boot upside down so that the weight falls through the smaller side. Pull the swab through several times. Place the boot joint in the case. If the reed is still in your mouth, put it in the reed case. When everything, swabs, straps, reeds, water, and bassoon are back in the case, make sure all the latches are fastened before picking the case up.
Richard has told us how to assemble the bassoon. It's time to sit down to play. And like everything, there's a right way to hold the bassoon. Let's practice getting seated properly. You will need a straight chair, one without arms, your bassoon, a seat strap, and a neck strap. If you need to gather up these things, put your VCR on pause and go now. You're back. Good. The most comfortable way to play the bassoon is sitting, using a seat strap to support the weight of the bassoon. Why not a neck strap? Let me quickly show you what happens using a neck strap when you're sitting. See how top-heavy the instrument becomes? If you play this way for long, it tends to pull you forward as your back and neck tire from the weight. This position makes seeing the conductor and the music difficult. It's much harder to breathe correctly. Your hand will go to sleep, and I guarantee you'll get a backache. The seat strap is much more comfortable. Your seat strap can be leather, a belt, a piece of webbing, anything not too slippery that a hook can be attached to. The hook goes onto a hole in the boot cup or onto a ring designed to fit around the cup if it doesn't have a hole drilled in it. From behind your chair, facing the video, place the seat strap on the chair midway with the hook end to your right, and leave plenty of the hook end hang over. Let's sit down and lay your bassoon across your lap to hook the strap to the boot. To adjust, lift your bassoon with your right hand and grasp the strap end with your left and pull, raising the instrument to a comfortable height. Let's take some practice. Try again to raise the bassoon and lift your knee slightly so the strap slides. Lift the bassoon and pull on the strap. Use your legs as a brake for the strap. Raise and lower a few times until you get the hang of it. It will become second nature very soon. Now, with some control over adjusting up and down, notice where the strap should be on the chair. If it's too far back, the instrument falls forward. Too close to the front, and you can't reach the reed easily. Sit up straight, comfortably, with your feet flat, and move the strap until the horn comes to you easily. Your arms and hands should comfortably grasp the instrument without gripping tightly. Turn the reed on the bocal so your head is looking forward, not tilted. Properly balanced, you don't need to do much to control the instrument, hopefully leaving you free to play it with ease. Remember, you're the boss here. Make the bassoon come to you. Save your energy for the music. Sometimes you will need to stand up to play, for instance, when playing the national anthem. To support the weight of the bassoon, use a neck strap. The hook goes onto a loop at the top of the boot joint. Adjust the strap so the reed is at your mouth. You don't want to have to reach with your head and neck to play. Like sitting, adjust the bassoon to you. If you elect to play a solo standing, make sure you practice standing and playing. Your arms and neck will tire quickly, so condition yourself to be able to play longer than your solo, comfortably standing. A few pointers on handling your bassoon. The bocal is very fragile. When seated, don't hold your bassoon by the bocal or hang on it. I bent one in half once. It was ruined, and my parents fainted when they saw the bill. Look at the key work and notice these long metal rods. These are easily bent by grabbing the bassoon in any way that puts pressure on them. To carry your horn, put your reed in your mouth or the reed box. Hold your bocal in one hand or put it in the bell like this. Make sure you take it out of the instrument. If you get bumped into walking around, it can cut your face. Pick up the bassoon by the metal band at the top of the boot joint. This avoids having all but the piece in your hand from bouncing on the floor. Use two hands or cradle it in your arm. Be aware of doors, ceiling fans, overhangs, and other hard, unyielding objects. Sitting or standing, occasionally take a look at yourself in the mirror to make sure that you're not developing bad posture habits. What often seems the easy way creates problems in technique, breathing, and can make you physically tired before you're done practicing or rehearsing. The point is to make playing as easy as possible. The fewer problems, the more you can focus on the music and have fun playing with friends.
The ability to produce a beautiful singing tone is one of the most important skills for the bassoonist to acquire. The first step to making a beautiful sound on the bassoon is to have a clear idea in your mind what you want to sound like. The best way to develop this concept is to listen to other bassoonists, either live or on recordings. Be aware when listening to recordings that French recordings will be played on French bassoons. Although often quite beautiful, this is not a sound you should try to emulate on a German bassoon. The bassoon is basically a quiet instrument, so it is important to make a big, confident sound so that your part will project to the audience and be heard. The most important aspect of making a good sound is to remember that the bassoon is a wind instrument. The sound is produced by a vibrating column of air. That column of air begins in your lungs, travels through your throat and mouth, into the reed and the bassoon. How you produce and shape that column of air will have a profound effect on how the bassoon sounds as you play. To get that air column off to a good start, it is important to use diaphragm breathing. To practice breathing properly, place your hands just below your last rib with your fingers together. As you inhale, the natural expansion down and out will separate your fingertips. Avoid tensing your shoulders. You will exhale in a quick, steady stream, keeping your abdomen firm but not tense to support the sound. As the column of air moves through your body on its way to the bassoon, it will pass through your throat and your mouth. Keep both your throat and the inside of your mouth open and relaxed, as if saying "aw," to help create a round, free-flowing sound. The next place the air passes is your lips. I'd like to take an extra minute to address your embouchure, or how you hold your lips on the reed. The column of air that began in your lungs is going to cause the reed to vibrate. This vibration is necessary to make the bassoon sound. If we press too hard on the reed with our lips, we cause it to vibrate less. This decreases the sound. We don't want this to happen, so it is important that we not put too much pressure on the reed. How much pressure do you need, and how should you position your lips? Your lip position when playing the bassoon should feel comfortable and natural without using your teeth or extreme contortions. Place most of the reed in your mouth, applying enough pressure to keep the air from escaping. Be sure your lips are not as far up as the wire. This will make it hard to play. Think of your lips as a gasket that seals the connection of your air column to the bassoon. Keep your mouth and throat open in the aw position and fill the bassoon with air supported from the diaphragm, and you will create a very pleasing sound. When you want to play softer, you will not squeeze your lips, nor will you use less breath support. You will simply move the air more slowly into the bassoon. This way you can maintain a full sound and good pitch, even when playing pianissimo. To review, the things you need to remember to make a good sound are diaphragm breathing to create breath support, a relaxed and open throat, the inside of the mouth in a round, aw position, a comfortable, natural, not a squeezed embouchure, and move that air in a steady stream. The last item I want to discuss at this time is articulation. If you listen carefully to how music is played, you will notice that there are infinite varieties of shapes of notes, depending on how they are attacked, held, and released. This variety is one of the factors that helps to make music as expressive as it is. On a wind instrument, all of these shapes are made on a column of moving air. Therefore, we don't start and stop that column with every note. If we did, our playing would sound very disjointed and static. We can create a flowing feel to the music we play by thinking of superimposing our articulation on that column of air. The tongue does not start the note, it acts as a valve to temporarily interrupt the column of air. We keep the air pressure going so that our tongue notes move in a direction to make a line of the music. When you tongue a note on the bassoon, you will touch the reed with a part of your tongue just behind the tip, as if saying two. But always keep the air going before and after the attack, so the tongue serves as a valve which interrupts the air column and then lets it continue. We're going to take a break now to play for you. This is some music of Robert Schumann.
One of the important aspects of playing any instrument is knowing the correct fingerings. The bassoon is no exception. And, unfortunately, there are many instances where students do not use the correct fingerings, either because they were never taught them or they forgot them. Wrong fingerings can lead to problems with intonation, tone, ease and sureness of attack, and make technical passages in music seem harder. Obviously, it is better for the student to learn the correct fingerings from the beginning. In this video, we will show each note and its fingering in a logical order for you to learn them. The three-octave range of the bassoon has been broken up into five ranges. The first is the basic scale from F down to F. These are the first notes you should learn. They are the easiest to play and can help you become comfortable playing the bassoon before tackling the technical aspects of the higher and lower registers. The second range presented are the lowest notes on the bassoon. There are some technical problems here, especially for someone who is changing to the bassoon from another instrument and has never had to use their thumb so much. The next range are the half-whole notes, which lie just over the break. The fourth range are the notes commonly referred to as the second register. The last group of notes, which is the upper register, should only be attempted when you are comfortable in the lower ranges and have a well-developed embouchure. This section of the video is designed so that you can follow along learning the notes as they are presented and also use it as a video fingering chart. Each note segment is started showing the note on the screen so that you can fast forward to the appropriate note to learn the fingering and any technique tips which may come in handy. One thing I want you to keep in mind about these fingering demonstrations. The finger positions you will see are exaggerated, in that fingers that are not involved in covering any holes or pressing any keys are held well away from the bassoon. This is to show you what fingers are needed to play the note. In actual playing, the fingers should be held close to the bassoon, as you can see in the sections of this video when we are playing trios. The basic scale of the bassoon is based on F, almost the same as the clarinet. We will start with fourth line F, which is played with only the whisper key, which is pressed with the left-hand thumb. E is fingered with the whisper key and the left hand first finger. D is fingered with the whisper key and fingers 1 and 2 of the left hand. C is fingered with the whisper key and fingers 1, 2, and 3 of the left hand. B is fingered with the whisper key, left hand 1, 2, 3, and the first finger of the right hand. A is fingered with the whisper key, left hand 1, 2, 3, and the first and second fingers of the right hand. G is fingered with the whisper key, left hand 1, 2, 3, and fingers 1, 2, and 3 of the right hand. Notice that the right hand third finger goes on the wider of the two keys, which is called the G key. F is fingered with the whisper key, left hand 1, 2, 3, right hand 1, 2, 3, and the F key, which is depressed by the fourth finger of the right hand. Notice the angle and position of the fingers. The left hand first and second fingers are slightly bent, while the third finger of the left hand is flat, closing the holes with the flat part of the fingers, not the tips. All the fingers of the right hand are held flat, not curved. The chromatic notes in this range are a bit more complicated than the basic scale, but as you practice them, they will become as easy as the regular notes. E flat or D sharp is played with a whisper key and a fork fingering, which is the first and third fingers of the left hand. If the pitch or tone is unsteady, it can be helped by adding the low E flat key, which is also called the resonance key, and is played with the left hand fourth finger. D flat or C sharp is fingered like C, whisper key 1, 2, 3, but the left thumb must simultaneously rock up to press the C sharp key next to the whisper key and drop the second joint down on the low D key. B flat or A sharp is played by fingering A, left hand whisper key 1, 2, 3, right hand 1, 2, and adding the top right thumb key, which is the standard B-flat key. A-flat or G-sharp is fingered like G. Left hand whisper key, 1, 2, 3. Right hand, 1, 2, 3. And by adding the A-flat key with the fourth finger of the right hand. F-sharp or G-flat, again, is fingered like G. Left hand whisper key, 1, 2, 3. Right hand, 1, 2, 3. But with the addition of the right thumb F-sharp key, which is below the key that looks like a pancake. Descending from F, it becomes necessary to rely on both thumbs and the left fourth finger. Low E is fingered like F. Left hand whisper key, 1, 2, 3. Right hand, 1, 2, 3. And the F key, but with the addition of the E, or pancake key. Low D is played with the left hand whisper key, 1, 2, 3. Right hand, 1, 2, 3. The F key and the E key, dropping the second joint of the left thumb onto the D key. Notice this is almost the same motion you needed for the C sharp in the staff. Low C is played almost like low D. It is fingered left hand, 1, 2, 3. Notice no whisper key. Right hand, 1, 2, 3. The F key, the E key, but the left thumb leaves the whisper key and is slid along the D key until the side of the knuckle depresses the low C key. Notice that when the C key is pressed, it also closes the D key. It is not necessary to press the whisper key for the lowest notes, as the low E closes it when it is depressed. Low B is fingered with the left hand, 1, 2, 3, right hand, 1, 2, 3, the F key, the E key, and the side of the tip of the thumb presses the low C and B keys. Low B flat is fingered like low B, left hand 1, 2, 3, right hand 1, 2, 3, F key, E key, and the left thumb closes the low C, B, and low B flat keys together. Low E flat or D sharp is played like low D, left hand whisper key 1, 2, 3, right hand 1, 2, 3, plus the F and E and D keys, but with the addition of the E flat key with the left hand fourth finger. Low C sharp or D flat is played like low C, left hand 1, 2, 3, right hand 1, 2, 3, plus the F, E, and C keys. Notice that the low C key also closes the low D key, and with the addition of the low C sharp key with a left fourth finger. If a musical passage descends only as low as D or E flat, it is easier for the player to keep the thumb on the whisper key and to press the low D key with the second joint of the thumb. When the music goes below D, the left thumb should be released from the whisper key so that it can reach the rest of the keys. The half hole is one of the trickiest aspects of bassoon playing. It is necessary for the notes just over the break, F sharp, G, and A flat, which are fingered just like their counterparts an octave lower, but using the half hole. It is done by moving the left hand first finger down so that a small portion of the hole is uncovered. It is actually much less than a half hole, but that expression gives you a better idea of what it is.
You should also remember that on any note you use the half hole, you should close the whisper key. One last thing to mention about these three notes is that you may need to add the low E-flat resonance key to any or all of these notes, since they may be sharp on some bassoons. G is fingered with a whisper key, half hole, 2-3 in the left hand, and fingers 1-2-3 of the right hand. F sharp or G flat is fingered like G, whisper key, half hole, 2-3 in the left hand, fingers 1-2-3 in the right hand, plus the thumb F sharp key next to the pancake key. A flat or G sharp is fingered like G, whisper key, half hole, 2-3 in the left hand, fingers 1-2-3 in the right hand, and with the A flat key with the right hand fourth finger. The notes from A up to D are fingered like the lower octave notes, but without the whisper key, and with a mental concept of playing higher, which should include an image of faster moving air. A is fingered with the left hand, 1-2-3, and fingers 1-2 of the right hand. B flat or A sharp is fingered left hand 1-2-3, right hand 1-2, and the top right thumb B flat key. B is fingered left hand 1-2-3, and the first finger of the right hand. C is fingered left hand 1-2-3. C sharp or D flat is fingered left hand 1-2-3, and the left thumb must depress the C sharp and low D keys. D is played with the left hand, fingers 1 and 2. Above E flat, fingerings get much more complicated, and you should continually refer back to this video in order to make sure you are using the correct fingerings. Before attempting to play the high register notes, you should feel very secure in all the previously presented notes, and again, should have a well-developed embouchure. Trying to play these notes before your embouchure has developed sufficiently can make your lip muscles tired and cause you to start biting the reed in order to make the notes come out. High E flat or D sharp is fingered left hand 1-2 and right hand 1-2-3. From high E upwards, it may be necessary to add the low E flat resonance key to help the tone and intonation of the upper register. High E is left hand 1-3 and right hand 1-2-3. High F is left hand 1-3 and right hand 1-2. High F sharp or G flat is fingered whisper key, half hole, 2-3 in the left hand, and first finger of the right hand. Notice that this note is fingered like second line B, but with a half hole. High G is whisper key, half hole, 2-3 in the left hand, and the first finger and the F key in the right hand. Notice that this is the same fingering as F sharp, but with the addition of the F key. High A-flat or G-sharp is like G in the left hand, whisper key, half whole, two, three, but with just the third finger of the right hand. For high A and B flat, the left thumb needs to be moved up to the next two keys, the C sharp key and the A key. High A is fingered with the two thumb keys, left hand 1, 2, 3, and the right hand third finger. Notice that this is almost like the fingering for A flat, except that there is no half hole and the thumb is on the two keys. High B flat or A sharp is like A in the left hand, the two thumb keys 1, 2, and 3, but the right hand uses the second finger and the fourth finger on the F key. There is also a technique known as flicking. The keys which are flicked are the A, B, and D keys. The motion used is a quick depression and release of the key when the note is to speak. This technique is used to facilitate upward slurs and to help the attacks on these notes if necessary. An easy way to practice using these keys is to play octave slurs low to high. The only change in the fingering is the thumb leaving the whisper key in order to flick the appropriate key. Bassoons with two flick keys, which are above the whisper and C-sharp keys, the lower is used for A and is called the A key. The top one is used for the notes B-flat through D and is called the B key. C-sharp or D-flat is the one note in this range which is not flicked because the thumb is already busy holding down two other keys. If the bassoon has a third flick key, it is the high D key. It is used to flick for D. Now we will play a piece that, believe it or not, uses all of these notes. Thank you.
Thank you.
Welcome to my video class on bassoon reeds. I feel like Julia Childs here. This is not a lecture on how to make reeds from scratch. Instead, I want to pass along information that hopefully will save you time, help you visually look for good qualities in the reeds you buy, and improve the performance of the reeds you are now using. Developing skills at reed making and adjusting is as important as practicing scales and etudes. There are a few very fine books available on reed making. I recommend investing in one or all of them, particularly if you do not have a regular private instructor. I wish I could sit beside each of you as we work on these reeds. You could stop me when there were questions. Instead, we'll rely on the wonders of video. I will work slowly. Please stop the tape and go back if you need to watch or hear a second time. To begin, I have arranged on this table the tools we will be working with. These are the very basic reed tools you should purchase and keep in your case. Some are available at your local hardware store. We'll start with those. A pair of needle-nose pliers with built-in wire cutters. Now, I've had this pair for 26 years. I don't know how many reeds that is. 400 or 320 grit wet or dry sandpaper. It comes in sheets like these, which you can cut into small squares or just tear off a piece like Roy does. You need a ruler, one like this 6-inch stainless steel holds up well, and look for one marked in 1/32 of an inch. The markings will be important later in your reed making career. You will want to have water to soak your reed. It's very handy to have a small container that has a watertight lid and fits in your case. This is perfect. Maybe your mom has one she will part with, or an empty film canister works about as well. The last four items you need to order through a woodwind supply shop, and they generally have catalogs for mail order. Check with your local music store. It's possible they could help you locate places to order. If you write to the address on the screen, we will be happy to forward a list of supply sources. Remember to include your address. The titles of the reed making books are on the list too. This is a mandrel. It fits into the reed so you can work without cutting or sanding your fingers. This small metal piece shaped like an arrowhead is a plaque. It slips between the blades to provide a solid surface when using a knife or sandpaper. Reed knives. There are basically two kinds, a razor type, like this one, and a beveled edge knife, like this one. When ordering the beveled edge, you must specify right or left hand. The final item you will need is a cutting block, and I will show you how to use this a little later on. Let's talk about where to get reeds. Do you make your own reeds? You're off to a great start if you do. Most advanced players make their own, but it takes a long time to get so you are completely self-sufficient. In the meantime, good sources are your private instructor or perhaps a local bassoonist. The catalogs mentioned earlier sometimes carry ready-made reeds, or your local music store. If they don't have them in stock, they should be able to order commercial reeds for purchase. Let's begin our discussion with commercial reeds. Sometimes you have the opportunity to look over a selection of reeds before you buy them. Using this batch I've made as examples, let's decide which ones look the best. Carefully pick up the reed. Now I'm going to use a mandrel just to keep my hands out of the way of the camera. Hold the reed up to a light source and look at the blades. One side, then the other. The reed should appear symmetrical. The side should be straight or have a slight flare, but no curves or gouges. The blades shouldn't have any bark on them. Looking at reed number one, we can see on one side the bark has not been cut away, and it has a gouge in the side of one blade. Let's pass it by and continue our search for a good reed. Once again, looking at the reed, Does the blade on the back side seem to hang over on the right or left? This one does. Sometimes the wood slips when the reed is being made. This isn't always bad if it didn't go too far. I've had them play well like this, but for now, we'll keep on looking. I'll put number two in the maybe pile. This is a good-looking reed. The blades line up behind each other nicely. Reed number three looks promising. Look for obvious damage, like cracks in the blade. Somebody must have stepped on this one. Sometimes cracks are not so easy to see, but are very small and just at the tip. Turn the reed so you can look at the tip opening and inspect for small cracks. Pull the reed back from your eyes. What shape is the tip opening? It should look something like this drawing in the center. Unless it is really open or almost closed shut, you may be able to adjust it after it is soaked up. Avoid the extremes. We'll pass on reed number four because of the crack in the blade and the tip opening is not a good shape. Let's look through the other end of the reed. Are there any pieces of wood clogging the tube, or is it completely clear so you can see out through the tip? Make sure the tube end is perfectly round. If it has been crushed, like this one, it is likely the reed won't ever play well, even if it were made round again. And finally, look at the wires. If they're a little bit loose, that's okay. They will tighten after the reed is soaked. The danger is in having them so tight that they cut into the wood. This is an example of wires pulled too tight. In reed number six, the wood has most likely been damaged from the wires, and we'll pass on this reed too. It looks like reed number three is our best choice of this batch. It has good overall shape. There are no cracks. The blades look bark-free and are smooth on both sides. It has a good tip opening, not too wide or closed shut. The bocal end is round and solid, and the wires are a little bit loose. I think we should buy it. Let's try out our new reed and see how it plays. I'll put it to soak while I arrange my tools. For this section, you may want to take notes or have your tools, reeds, and bassoon handy while I demonstrate the cures for some likely problems occurring with new reeds. If, after you have tried a new reed and discovered one or more of these problems, you can refer back to this section of the video to watch how I solved that particular problem. Put the video on pause if you need to go and get something. This is soaked up pretty well. Always soak a reed for a few minutes before playing or adjusting it. And let me test it out. Well, the first problem I hear is the E in the staff is falling flat. Listen to the sure test for this common problem. I will play C, D, E in the staff and listen for the E. This sounds pretty bad, but it is simple to fix. The cause? The reed is too long. The solution? We cut it off. Little by little, testing between each cut. You can always cut it off. You can't put it back on. To trim it, take the cutting block and your reed knife. Carefully now, move slowly. No need to be in a big rush. Place the reed blade down with the tip in the center of the block. You don't want the block to shift when we make the cut. Looking straight down on the reed, place the knife like so, keeping the knife perpendicular to the reed. Look at the position of my hands. I use my left thumb to apply even pressure. Once again, check the alignment of your knife. The cut must be straight. Push the knife down and rock forward and back to complete the cut. I recommend practicing on an old reed that is ready for the trash. And please, do this on a solid table, not your knee or a chair. You will cut yourself or ruin a good reed if you get in a hurry or sloppy in your technique. Let me try it again. Still a little bit of a drop. The alternative to the cutting block are these jeweler's nippers. They are available at a jeweler's supply store and are much safer and quicker. Once again, line up your tiny cut, keeping the nippers perpendicular to the reed, and squeeze until the cut is complete. We'll try it again. Good. The E is solid now, so this reed is about the right length. For my playing comfort, this reed is too stiff. A reed will often be harder to blow after the tip is cut. To correct this, there are different things that we can do. The first remedy I try is to adjust the tip opening by squeezing the wire at the reed's throat. This will flatten the tube, causing the tip to close. Just a reminder, for now, make all the moves to adjust your reed small. Trim tiny amounts, squeeze the wires just a bit. As you become accustomed to performing these skills, you will learn to judge how much to do at one time. Be as patient as you can with yourself and the reed. When you start to feel frustrated, put the reed, the bassoon down, and come back later. You will save yourself a lot of times and reeds in the long run. I've closed the tip opening a bit. Let me play it to see. That helps. If at this point the reed is still too stiff, for instance, it's really hard to blow, you can shave down the back area of the blades near the throat wire. Watch closely. I'll put the reed on the mandrel snugly and carefully place the plaque between the blades. We will be working in this area of the blade from this pencil line back with the reed knife using a very moderate amount of pressure. With good clean strokes, pull back with the knife, working from left to right, starting from the pencil line midway on the blade back to the bark. An important point to remember here, whatever is done to one side of the blade must be done to the other to maintain balance. So I will turn it over and duplicate the knife strokes exactly. The length of cut, the pressure, should be exactly like the first. And don't hesitate to mark on the reed with the pencil as I have done in the examples. It will help keep you honest. Okay, we put the knife down, grab one of the squares of 400 grit, and gently sand the area we used the knife on. This will remove any small gouges the knife blade made and smooths out the reed surface. Brush away the scrapings. A soft toothbrush works fine for this. And I'll play it again. Much better. The technique we just finished, scraping the back of the reed, is an effective solution for a very stiff reed. For a reed that is just a little bit stiff, a lighter scraping can be done that looks like this. Again, our mandrel and the plaque and the knife. Look at the pencil markings. I will be working between the lines. This time, I'll make full-length throat-to-tip scrapes, working left to right, very methodically, trying to cover every inch of the reed surface between my pencil lines. Now, I'm not taking any wood off the rails at this point. It tends to make the tone sound dark. And the rails are the very outer edges outside my pencil marks. A pointer here, if you're having problems holding the mandrel and the knife, look at my hands and try to copy how I have my fingers. This is how I do it. First the mandrel with the reed, and I use my forefinger to support the reed. And the reed knife, I grip the knife handle with my fingers. I use my left thumb as a brace or a pivot for the knife blade. The scraping movement is in the wrist, not the arm. Try to be very controlled. Don't use too much tension. There's no death grips necessary here. Back to scraping my reed. I'm using this technique to lighten up or thin the entire face of the reed, both sides, so that it will play or respond more easily. In general, the thinner the wood, the more freely it vibrates. I'll lightly sand with the 400 grit. And see what damage I've done. This reed away for a couple of days. No more work on it right now. For whatever reason, it seems to work out better for reeds if you don't try to do too much too fast. Work a little one day, put it away for 2 or 3 days, then do a little more work. They seem to develop into better reeds and last longer. We'll do anything that makes a good reed last longer. This next reed is pretty good, but I need a quicker response for a fast tonguing passage and some soft attacks. The area to work on to improve response is the tip. Looking at the example, see the area I have outlined in pencil? Using the knife, I will follow the pencil line as my start point and make straight scrapes right off the end of the reed. One trip across on this side. Turn it over, and again, exactly duplicating my moves to keep my reed in balance. I'll lightly sand with 400. Being careful not to use too much pressure on the tip. Both sides. Time to test my work. just another light sanding would improve it further. Note that you don't always have to use a knife. 320 grit sandpaper will take off more wood than 400, and the knife more than sandpaper. Experience will teach you what to use and how much is enough in most cases. The last technique in reed making I have for today is what to do for the too soft, mushy feeling reed. Most likely, it has already had too much wood removed. This really limits our options for improving the reed. Opening the tip by squeezing the outside edges of the first wire should increase resistance. Pinching closed the second wire, top and bottom, also opens the tip, creating even more resistance. You may have to play with these wires to find the best combination. Test the E in the staff. If it sinks, trim the tip. Often this will make the reed stiffer. If nothing seems to help, trim it whether the E sinks or not. At this point, you probably don't have much to lose. If it helps, test the reed with a tuner. It may be on the sharp side if it's become too short. One last point I want to bring up. Now that we have at least one good reed, it should be protected as much as possible. There are many commercially made reed boxes, but many players use the metal boxes throat lozenges come in. For the inside, fold Kleenex to pad the top and bottom, making it thick enough so that the reed doesn't rattle around in the box. Holes can be drilled in the top to aid in air circulation. I put labels on my boxes, usually with the date or stage of development of the reeds. Your name is a good idea. If possible, try to have three or four reeds that you can rotate. They last much longer if allowed to dry out a couple days between use. I've enjoyed this section. If you need the list of catalogs, write and ask. We'll be pleased to pass them along. I think Roy and Richard are waiting on me to play another trio. We'll perform for you the Weisenborn Polka.
Thank you.
Before you can hope to play well, you need to have a good instrument that is in good condition. The easiest way to select a bassoon and to assure that it is working well is to enlist the assistance of an experienced bassoonist. The quality of manufacturing and servicing varies widely, so professional advice can be very helpful. If this is not available, here are some important considerations to achieve the best results. The bassoon must be at least a basic 21 or 22 key German, also known as a Heckel system bassoon. Virtually all the bassoons in this country fit this description. You want to be sure that your bassoon has a whisper key. If you have many fewer keys, especially on the boot joint, that's this part, you may have a French style bassoon. The French bassoon is not commonly used in schools or symphonies in the United States, and so you should attempt to get a German bassoon to play. Many bassoons are made of wood, but there are some very fine instruments being made today of a black plastic known as polypropylene. The bocal you play on will have a huge effect on how well your bassoon plays. It will affect your overall pitch, tone quality, and the ease with which your instrument plays. Often, the most cost-effective way to improve your equipment is to get a better bocal. Inspect the bassoon visually to be sure that all the keys move freely and that there are no pads missing or other obvious problems, such as cracks in the wood. Be sure that all of the pads are seating properly and that the bassoon is not leaking. The wing joint and the boot joint are by far the most critical parts to test for leaks. If they are not sealing properly, the bassoon will be very difficult to play. There is a simple test to be sure that these are tight. You can perform this suction test on each of these joints. For the wing, you can seal the lower end against the meaty part of your leg. If you can't get a seal on your leg, you may want to use your finger. Be sure the three holes are covered with the fingers of your left hand, then suck the air out to create a seal with your lip. It will probably take a number of small puffs to remove enough air to feel suction. The wing joint should be able to hold suction for a minimum of 3 seconds. A bassoon in really top condition will seal for a full minute. This kind of air tightness in a bassoon can do a lot to increase the resonance. If you can't get suction, often you can locate the problem by pressing the pads one by one and trying again. A suction test on the boot can be a little trickier, but if you try a couple times, you'll get the knack. Hold the boot with your right hand, fingering a low E so all the holes and keys are closed. Seal the small opening with your cheek and suck the air out of the larger opening with your lips. Again, you want to create a partial vacuum so that you will feel suction for at least 3 seconds before it releases. If you have a leak in the boot that you can't localize to a specific key, it may be leaking around the U-tube, either around the cork or between the metal cap and the wood. This is something a competent repair person can easily detect and repair. You can also do a suction test on your bocal. Cover the hole on the nib and the cork and suck the air out of the other end. It should be easy to get suction that will last almost indefinitely. If it's leaking, it will be very difficult to play on, but it can usually be repaired. The long and the bell joints are not as critical to how the instrument as a whole plays. These can be tested with a pressure test. For the long joint, seal the large end with your leg, or your hand if you can't get it to seal on your leg, depress the D, C, and B keys with moderate pressure, about the same as you would use to play these notes, and blow into the small end. If the joint is tight, you will feel a substantial amount of back pressure and no air will escape. If you have a leak, you'll hear the air escaping, and you can often find it by pressing on one pad at a time until you locate the problem. It looks like I need some help with this pad. It was easy to find because I could hear where the leak was and feel the air on my hand. You can test the bell using the same method. Just lightly close the B-flat pad and blow. This appears to be fine. The final test of any instrument, of course, is playing it. You should get a nice, even sound and response from top to bottom. If you are having problems with a particular note or group of notes, these may be due to mechanical problems. Other important factors to check are that the joints fit together well so that they are neither so tight that it is difficult to assemble or disassemble the instrument, or so loose that it falls apart or is wobbly. Many bassoons swell and shrink enough with the changing of the seasons that it is necessary to add or remove a little bit of the thread wrapping on the tenons once or twice a year. The tenon is this end part of the joint that fits inside another piece. Thread wrappings are preferable to cork because they provide greater protection for the tenon. This is especially true for the long joint because of the thinness of the wood. Always be extra careful when handling this part of the bassoon, as the ends are susceptible to damage. The thread should just be laid on the tenon, not wrapped tightly. If they are wrapped too tightly, it can cause a bulge that you can feel when you run your finger along the bore toward the end of the joint. It's a good idea to lubricate your keywork about twice a year. Just a drop of instrument key oil or sewing machine oil is all it takes to reduce wear and keep key noise to a minimum. Don't forget to oil your rollers when you do this. Be sure you swab out the boot every time you use the instrument. Richard explained how to do this in the section on taking the bassoon apart. Moisture will collect as you play and can cause serious damage to the bore on the unlined side of the boot if you don't dry it out. When you take a break in practice or rehearsal, be sure to take the instrument apart and empty the moisture from the boot before laying the instrument down. This way, that moisture won't damage the bore. Finally, the bassoon, as with any musical instrument, should be inspected and regulated by a competent repair person at least once a year. It is a fairly complex contraption, and small mechanical problems can cause major headaches for the performer.
We hope you have learned something from this video, but we know that you cannot become a bassoonist just by watching us. We have presented the basics for you to start playing the bassoon, but now it's your turn. You have to start practicing. The best thing for you to use at this point is a method book. There are several that we have used in our teaching and can recommend. The first is The Practical Method for Bassoon by Julius Weisenborn, published by Carl Fisher. This is primarily a book for those of you who have played another instrument before attempting the bassoon and have a great deal of musical knowledge. For those of you who are less experienced musically, one of the following books would be a good one for you. Bassoon Student Levels 1, 2, and 3 by Henry Payne, published by Belwin. The Rubank Method, which consists of three books, Elementary, Intermediate, and Advanced, by J.E. Skornica, published by Rubank. Learn to Play the Bassoon by William Eisenhower, published by Alfred, and A Tune a Day by C. Paul Herforth, published by the Boston Music Company. These books proceed logically through the early stages of playing the bassoon, and by combining what we have presented in this video with the exercises and studies in these books, you'll be able to have fun playing the bassoon and to make a musical contribution to your school band and orchestra. If your band director is not sure of exactly what you need to do to play the bassoon and can only offer you a small amount of help, the following books can help clarify some of the more puzzling aspects of playing the bassoon. The first is Primary Handbook for Bassoon by Richard Polanchak, published by Meredith Music Publications. The second is Technical Growth for the Bassoonist by Edmund Sinecki, published by Ludwig. Both of these books have plenty of written information on playing the bassoon and some exercises to demonstrate. Once you have worked through the above method books, you may want additional music to play. Etudes are study pieces that are usually longer than exercises in method books and give you more practice on some aspect of playing the bassoon, such as certain keys, certain rhythms, dynamic variations, style, attacks, etc. The book that is considered the most inclusive etude book by bassoonists is Etudes, Opus 8, by Julius Weisenborn. This is a very thorough and complete etude book, but just like Weisenborn's practical method, it is best used by someone who has had some previous musical experience. For those who are not quite as experienced, you'll want to look at Practical Studies for the Bassoon, Books 1 and 2, by Paul McDowell, published by Belwin, or Bassoon Studies, by Eugene Jancourt, published by Belwin. There are also Studies and Melodious Etudes for Bassoon and Tunes for Bassoon Technique books, which correspond to the Bassoon Student Method books I mentioned earlier. After you've gained some experience on the bassoon, you may want to play something a bit more musical and challenging than the exercises in the method books, or you may want your friends to hear you play away from the band. Fortunately, there are many solos for the bassoon, ranging from very easy ones to very difficult ones, so you can find some to play that are right at your level of experience. Here are three brief lists of some suggested solos, graded approximately to how long you have played. The grade 1 solos are for people who have been playing less than a year, and the grade 2 and 3 solos are for those who have been playing longer. Let me emphasize that these are only representative lists. There are many more published, and you can probably find some, or at least order them, at your local music store. If you would like a more complete list of recommended method books, etude books, or solos, please write to the address on the screen. We hope you have enjoyed watching our video. Thanks for watching. Thank you.